in a quite interesting architecture gallery in Hamburg that is run by architects. It's called Blauraum, Salon Blauraum. And this is an extra space in addition to their office. It's this space, as you can see, it can transform. It has corked walls, so they can hang plants very easily. It looks like this. It has a bar that unfolds. So it can be either just a bar, or it can be also an exhibition. The architects basically did it because they said, we spend so much time in the office and have no social life anymore, so let's bring our social life into our office, so that we... 10 projects of Sanabuga, and invented a fictitious description about these for these projects, which was not describing what they are in reality in terms of their function, but which was describing what the program could be if we would only judge based upon the atmosphere of the architecture. So we basically pretended, I'll give you an example, we pretended not to know the programs of these buildings. Let's take this as a good example. This is actually the Chamber of Commerce of Slovenia. But we were asking ourselves, what would we think this building has as a program if we didn't know? If we were only to judge from appearances. So we invented a story that this is a senior residence for elderly people who want to live in the city and have a large spa landscape, which is underneath the plaza level. And there's different kinds of medical services stacked upon each other, and so on. And then it becomes this kind of aged people's club landscape. And the interesting thing was the texts, although they, you know, they're not like 100% serious, they're maybe 99.5% serious, but there's a small rest of doubt in it. The texts are fairly convincing. The people in the exhibition would actually look at these things and basically believe these. And then there was a second space where they could study like the technical documentation of the projects. And these projects, we disclosed the actual identity of the projects. So we were saying, this is a Chamber of Commerce. And what happened was actually that people were here and said, oh, okay, there's this spa landscape, a swimming pool underneath the plaza. Now let's go to the plans and check where it is. And then they only found a car park. What the hell is this? And then they understood that there were two stories about a building. But it was fantastic because people basically went back and forth and really sort of played the game of these possible identities. Of some, and then basically what we wanted to communicate with is our entire built environment could also have a totally different narrative. Could also work totally differently, and it wouldn't need to be necessarily what it is. And sometimes we may change the city by just inventing and reinventing new identities. It's a little bit something that this record makes. I don't know if it's a very, very interesting record by Yoshinori Sunahara. He's a Japanese DJ and composer, and he made this very beautiful record called Takeoff and Landing, which is entirely devoted to the theme of flying. Let's listen to the beginning of the record, which is doing what we're trying to do in this exhibition.
This is a home. These are buildings. This is an airport. Take off.
Yeah, and then it actually starts. Well, the cool thing about this piece is, I think, that it puts you on a scenographic journey into an impossible environment. I mean, the airport, some hundred levels below ground, is sort of impossible. But it's beautiful how this piece in the beginning of this record taints your imagination for the entire duration that you listen to it. So it takes you away in this kind of airplane fiction. And yeah, that's basically what we're trying to do in our work as well. Another example of the type of project we do is this project called Endless Bauhaus. It was a video interview collage exhibition installation project in a big exhibition about Bauhaus in Berlin last year. And the problem of this show was that it was called Modell Bauhaus, which is actually a quite nice name. However, it was only about the history of the Bauhaus, only from the classic period that the Bauhaus was in Germany. It didn't research how the Bauhaus was applied, ideas of the Bauhaus were applied elsewhere after the war, in different continents, in different cultures, which I always think is much more interesting than the Bauhaus itself. And that's also what the Bauhaus itself wanted. It wanted to propagate new lifestyles, new ways of living, new ways of understanding the city. At some point, the exhibition curators understood that this was a problem, and they needed some contemporary perception of the Bauhaus as well. And they commissioned us to make this interview collage piece, where we basically tried to interview a couple of contemporary designers about what the Bauhaus meant to them. Whether it was still important, whether it was only historical, what if its utopian ambitions were still useful for us, and which not. And these people were friends like Michael Rock, that's the lead designer of 2x4, this project we've seen before, the t-shirts. Karin Böhmen, architectural historian, Jean-Philippe Vassal, you probably know. Ole Baumann, director of the NAI in Rotterdam. Olaf Eliasson, artist in Berlin. Bjarke Ingels, architect in Big. Olaf Nikolai, artist from Berlin. Chris Bangle, ex-BMW car designer. Pierre Vittoria Aureli, architecture teacher in Heberlachen Institute. Christian Gärtner, it's a designer, and they have a website called Style Park, where you can choose design objects. The database, basically. And Barbara Steiner, who's an art curator in Leipzig. So we made these interviews. You actually can see the film on our website, on textbook. And the interesting thing is that these perceptions were obviously totally contradictory. And we found very, very different attributes in relationship to the Bauhaus. And so we collected these kind of attributes that were given to the Bauhaus so that you could actually form a phrase like, the Bauhaus is excessive. Or the Bauhaus is idealistic. And if I just run through these attributes, you understand how diversified our notion of this hallmark of early modernism is that you perceived. And these words, like this one, we try to sort of not only make them rational descriptions of what the Bauhaus is, but we wanted to make them emotional and very personal in the experience of this installation piece. So what we actually did is we knew that this exhibition would be featuring many, many chairs, because the Bauhaus made so many fantastic chairs, or famous chairs. However, none of them would be allowed to be seated on. And basically what happens is that after some hours in an exhibition, people have hurting knees and want to sit someplace, somewhere. So what we did is basically we created a seating pattern and produced cushions and printed the names of these attributes on them. So this is where they could actually sit. And what was interesting now in this moment, as people saw, oh, that's fantastic, once a place where I actually can sit and relax. They couldn't just relax and sit down because they had to make a choice. Where do I put my bottom on it? Can I afford to be dogmatic, to be seen as dogmatic? Am I vital enough to sit on the dead cushion? And it was actually interesting because some cushions were more used than others. And you could actually basically make a statement by where you would place yourself. So if you put yourself on sexy, it's quite a statement. Because then this statement was no longer only the attribute didn't only finish the phrase, the Bauhaus is sexy, but it also, by yourself seating on it, you made a statement, I am sexy, or I am dead, or I am opportunistic, or I'm excessive. And basically people did this, but what was also nice is that actually people then understood they could play with these things and appropriate them and make themselves comfortable. So it's, you get combinations. Fandelbar means negotiable. So if death becomes negotiable, that's kind of, you know, relieving to some extent. This was how the piece looked. We had five big monitors and people could see this exhibition, see this piece. And it was very interesting because it was actually a 75-minute long interview film, and that's actually something too long to see. But we looped it, and we montaged it in such a way that you could actually see 5 minutes that would make sense, or also the entire thing. And there was no beginning and no ending. You could just like drop in and out. But that's what people were doing. I think I need to skip some part of the lecture that I had planned, so that I'm not going over time. I will probably fast forward.
That's okay.
Really? Okay. We like a lot this film. You probably know it. It's Odyssey 2001 by Stanley Kubrick. And this is the last, one of the last scenes in the film. And I've seen the movie many, many times, and I always get enthralled by this moment because Kubrick managed so fantastically to not resolve the riddle of the scene. He doesn't give us an answer how we have to understand this moment. This is so contradictory, where the astronaut, after this failed space expedition, the only one surviving it, lands on some faraway planet, and the first thing he lands on, the first space he enters is this one. The sudden encounter of a rococo interior and a lit ceiling gone floor. And often I think architecture doesn't have the courage to keep contradictions unresolved. Architects feel compelled to make sense. And sometimes I think it's exactly the impossibility to make sense of a situation that actually makes you curious, that gets you hooked, that creates an emotional bonding with a space. So a space that can be both rococo and space age may be more enticing than just a space that has one of those pure qualities. This is the simultaneity of opposing things is something that Robert Venturi studied in his Complexity and Contradiction, an architecture book, and it's one of the principles that he proposed. It's the both and principle, the principle of things that actually modernist architects would always have the feeling they need to choose either. You make a beautiful facade, you make a facade that basically receives its definition from the structure behind. I mean, these either or distinctions. And Venturi basically proposed the possibility that you could do both things at the same time.